In the last video, we talked about how Infinity Ward was founded by Vince Sempella, Grant Collier, and Jason West after leaving the company 2015, right before the release of the studio's groundbreaking title Medal of Honor Allied Assault, in order to gain complete creative freedom for their own new startup project titled Call of Duty. It turned out to be both a critical and commercial success and delivered an unprecedented level of authenticity in World War shooters. People were eagerly waiting to see where the future would take Activision's new flagship franchise. So, without further ado, I'm Drifter.
And I'm Ragnar, and this is the history of Call of Duty. After Call of Duty's release, there was no question that Infinity Ward would immediately begin working on the sequel. Jason West had, even before its huge success, stated that the studio's intention was to create not only a single game or even a franchise, but to establish Call of Duty as a new brand. And of course, this was in Activision's best interest. But just as the designers had met resistance for their ideas back when making Medal of Honor Allied Assault, history was about to repeat itself. Because Infinity Ward didn't envision COD solely as a World War II series, but they intended to shift the sequel's direction to a modern military setting. Their publisher was completely against it, as market research indicated no significant demand for this largely uncharted territory in war shooters. They weren't ready to take chances and wanted to play it safe. And so they dictated Call of Duty 2 to become a direct successor that would once again be set in World War II.
Additionally, one lone sequel wasn't enough for Activision. They just had their most successful business year in the company's entire history, and they would be foolish not to capitalize on the overwhelming potential that the new series had to offer. So while Infinity Ward would be busy for the next 2 years working on the sequel, Activision assigned contracted third-party developers to produce more Call of Duty products that would be released in the next fiscal year. Grey Matter Interactive was tasked with an expansion pack intended to compete with Medal of Honor's highly successful add-ons Spearhead and Breakthrough. Call of Duty United Offensive released in September 2004 and brought three new campaigns featuring British, American, and Russian troops to the original game. It included some historical battles, such as the Battle of Kursk on the Russian side and the Battle of the Bulge in the Belgian Ardennes Forest. And much like the first game, it took heavy artistic inspiration from HBO's Band of Brothers TV show.
Yet another thorn in Activision's side was the original COD's PC exclusivity, meaning they didn't get a cut of the growing console market share. So consequently, developer Spark Unlimited worked on a console spin-off known as Call of Duty Finest Hour for PS2, Xbox, and GameCube that was released in the same year. Despite the releases being commercially well received, they were widely regarded as inferior to the original. While they managed to capture the style and narrative scale, the overall sentiment was that they lacked the original's finesse and polish.
At this point, all eyes were on Infinity Ward and Call of Duty 2, which was being developed with multiple platforms in mind this time around. The expectations were monstrous, so monstrous in fact, that the project caught the attention of Microsoft, who were planning to release the new Xbox 360 console in late 2005, but they were facing a huge problem. Their number one console seller, Halo 3, would not be finished in time for launch. They needed a new launch title that would draw in customers, and Call of Duty 2 was the ideal candidate. Activision made a deal with Microsoft to release the game exclusively on Xbox 360. There would still be a PC version, but the PlayStation 3 version would be left out.
Infinity Ward stayed busy further enhancing the old id Tech 3 engine, transforming it into the first iteration of their proprietary IW engine. The development team traveled the world to visit and analyze historic battlefields, recorded audio of authentic weaponry in different surroundings, and consulted historians and veterans to turn their sequel into an even more accurate portrayal of World War II history. But Activision once again felt that the game's upcoming release on PC and 360 only would leave a significant portion of the market untapped, so they got yet another third-party developer on board to work on a sequel to Finest Hour, the console spin-off we just talked about, known as Call of Duty Big Red One. It would be released for current-gen consoles of that time, namely the Xbox, PS2, and GameCube, alongside with COD 2. Now, naming it Call of Duty 2 with an added subtitle had, for many people, a certain bootleg movie ring to it. You know, those films that a grandmother would buy the grandchildren for Christmas when they asked for Star Wars Episode 1 The Phantom Menace, but instead found Star Wars science fiction performed distinctive beneath the Christmas tree because poor granny couldn't tell the difference. Actually, I think I would prefer this one over the original.
As you say it. In the case of Call of Duty, it would mean that many people who heard about Call of Duty 2 from their friends would be delighted to learn that it's also available for their current gen console, except that it's a knockoff, and not a cheap one to be fair. To develop Call of Duty 2 Big Red One, Activision chose a studio that had been around since 1996, one which would soon become an inseparable part of the franchise's history, Treyarch. They went to great lengths to establish a cinematic touch. For example, they hired a large portion of Band of Brothers' original cast to do the voice acting.
In November 2005, the games were released for their respective systems, and as expected, both became instant bestsellers. Infinity Ward's Call of Duty 2 sold 250,000 units in the first week alone, almost double the sales of its predecessor. And while Treyarch's Big Red One was unsurprisingly considered inferior to COD 2 in almost every aspect, mostly due to its stunted development time and a significantly lower budget, Infinity Ward's true sequel was once again internationally met with overwhelming approval.
Technically superior in every way, the single-player mode followed the same formula as its predecessor, a Soviet campaign taking place in Moscow and Stalingrad, a British offensive set in North Africa, and a series of US battles all over Normandy that depicted yet another perspective of the famous D-Day landing. Even though the game stayed true to the formula, according to Vince Zampella, they realized after the launch of the first game, in hindsight, that they would have liked to do a few things differently. For instance, Call of Duty 1 featured a handful of lone wolf missions typical of the Medal of Honor stylings that would send the player on their own against an entire battalion of German soldiers, missions which were widely considered to be the weakest part of the entire game. With COD 2, they moved completely away from this old trope and focused almost exclusively on squad-based battles on an epic scale. The game also introduced context-sensitive squad chatter that would not only feel authentic, but would give you sensitive intel on the current tactical situation. So for example, you would hear, "German infantry! There's a sandbag!
Take out their infantry!" It was also the first entry in the series to drop the age-old health pack system in favor of an auto-heal mechanic, known most prominently from the Halo series. This has often been criticized for watering down the game's hardcore essence and moving it away from realism, but let's be honest. Getting shot by a handful of MG42 bullets, picking up some bandages, and having your wounds instantly vanish is equally far from a realistic portrayal of armed combat. From a game design perspective, the auto-heal system complements the way Call of Duty leads players through its narrative. The classic medkit system underlines the exploration and maze-like level architecture of Doom-style shooters. But COD's level design doesn't revolve around said exploration, instead focusing on tightly scripted corridors filled with dramatically orchestrated action sequences. Dropping the health bar mainly gives level designers the freedom to consistently understand exactly how difficult they can design each passage of the game without making it next to impossible for wounded players to make it through, and thereby further improving the cinematic choreography.
Just like its predecessor, Call of Duty 2 also came with a multiplayer mode, this time allowing up to 64 players over LAN and internet, or through Xbox Live to fight each other in classic modes such as Deathmatch, Team Deathmatch, Search and Destroy, and Capture the Flag. Activision was pleased with the results of their double launch. The franchise was growing steadily and the company's future was looking bright. But as we've seen, the publisher wouldn't be satisfied with only one release every 2 years. Infinity Ward was instantly tasked with working on the next sequel. From this point onward, Activision wanted one major Call of Duty release every year, and to add insult to injury, Infinity Ward would lose exclusive ownership of the main series. It was never officially confirmed, but the general word is that they, of course, were less than pleased with that decision from above.
Join us next time to see how Treyarch finds their way into the yearly Call of Duty loop, and how Infinity Ward finally makes the transition away from World War II to bring warfare to the modern age. Thanks for watching. Make sure to subscribe to Drifter to not miss out on the next parts of the history of Call of Duty, and if you're interested in more video game history or game design and analysis, feel free to visit me on my channel Ragnaroks. I'll see you on the other side.